we don't knock on the door of administration saying, we'd like to give a lecture to your medical students that's going to challenge everything you're teaching them. Fortunately, podcasters like you and the social media, one thing it has done is made some powerful truths available to the general public. In every medical school class, every first, second, third year medical school class, there's 20, 30, 40 students. They've seen films like Forks Over Knives. They've seen What the Health. They've seen Cowspiracy. The door has been opened intellectually for me. And we go through that door and swing it wide open and say, this is, you're not crazy. This is where you want to be looking.
All right. Welcome to the Fit Vegan Podcast. I'm your show host, Maxim Seguin, and I'm the founder and CEO of Fit Vegan Coaching, a company that is on a mission to help 10,000 people get lean, thrive, and reduce their risk of chronic illnesses by 2033 and a million by 2050. I believe that having a fit, healthy body in mind is the foundation to living an incredible life. And this is what the show will give you if you choose to listen and implement. Enjoy the episode and have a great day. All right. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to another episode of the Fit Vegan Podcast. Today, I'm joined by a very special guest, which is second appearance on the show, which is Dr. Klaper. Dr. Klaper, how are you doing today?
I'm doing just fine. It's lovely to be back with you and your viewers. Thanks for the invitation.
Yes, of course. I know we had a great conversation last time, and I was looking through our archive, and it was almost 2 years ago that we recorded. And I just found that very interesting because I know we're both on a mission to want to empower people to heal and live on a plant-based lifestyle. And I think my intro at the time said that we had helped 350 people the last time we recorded together. And now we're over 750 people. So we're able to impact an additional 400 lives in the past 2 years since we last spoke.
Great.
Very yeah. Mm-hmm. And so today I wanted to dive into some of the work that you're doing with doctors, right? So you're very much focused on moving medicine forward and empowering doctors to prescribe a plant-based lifestyle as a means of healing the patient versus the other modalities, right? Which would be surgery, yes, pills, medication, and all that. And so I'd love to dive into why that is. Why is the system the way that it is now? How we can do things differently? How are you contributing to that change? And then empowering the people listening that may not have a doctor that's as cool as you.
Sure. No, those are all very important topics, and it helps to focus in the bigger picture there. So I'll be glad to explore that with you.
Awesome. So yeah, let's just start with like, why do you think the medical system is currently structured the way that it is? And what would be like the ideal of what it should be?
Right. Yes. Well, Western medicine has taken kind of a strange turn there in many ways. And a number of influences are having sway, and without dipping into conspiracy land about big pharma and big ag and all that, which do influence what doctors learn in medical school. I'm not going to negate that.
Yeah.
But since about the 1930s, with the advent of the early antibiotics, sulfa drugs, and then later penicillin, the model of modern medicine having kind of one drug to for this whatever disease it is, pneumonia or meningitis, and there's no question those drugs were and still are miraculous if for treating severe infections, and Western medicine is just excellent at dealing with acute care situations. I had a chief resident, I was a med student, who said, "Listen, you could divide all of medicine into horizontal medicine and vertical medicine. If you are horizontal, you are so sick or so injured that you are horizontal on the gurney, Western yeah. medicine is just what you need. We're really good at pulling people out of the jaws of death there and patching their bodies together. We're great at horizontal medicine." But that's about 10% of all the medical interactions. 90% of the time, it's vertical medicine. Your patients are walking around, but they don't feel good. They're not functioning well. And they've got chronic diseases, chronic inflammation, obstruction, etc. And Western medicine doesn't really know what to do with that. We've got drugs that'll lower the symptoms, can force your blood pressure down, force your cholesterol down, but it's not getting at the root of the problem. And we can see from all the graphs in public health world now, when you look at obesity rates and death rates from heart disease and cancers, et cetera, they're all going up. As wonderful as modern medicine is, it's not making us healthier. There's something is being overlooked here. What could it be? And of course, those of us who are in nutrition and lifestyle medicine know very well what the issue is. It's what our patients are eating. It's the food. And again, the Western diet. In the space of my medical career, I've been a doc for 50 years, 53 years. And in those years, in those decades, I've seen the Western diet change. We've become a fast food nation. We've become an obese nation, et cetera. And it's accepted as normal that you have an Egg McMuffin for breakfast and a cheeseburger for lunch and pizza for dinner and ice cream for dessert. And this kind of eating style sends waves of fat and cooked animal muscle and dairy protein and vegetable oils and salt and sugar through the bloodstream hour after hour, day after day, month after month, year after year. And to those of us in lifestyle medicine, it's no surprise why we're getting more obese and sick and inflamed, etc. And yet my noble profession, who is expert, I often muse, we are good at identifying a genetic mismatch on gene A21 on chromosome 14. Boy, we could home in on that with precision. But the thought that cheeseburgers and buffalo wings might be injuring our patients' arteries, this is about too abstruse a concept. I'm being silly and a little cynical, but not really. And it's stunning to me that we just don't want to, as a profession, we don't want to look at what our patients are eating. Because for all sorts of reasons, doctors aren't trained in it. We're not paid to do this kind of counseling. And the doctors are eating the same foods themselves. They love their steak and their burgers, and I can tell their patients not to eat it. So we're kind of locked in to this paradigm where patients come in with some complaint, obesity, diabetes, high blood pressure. We focus on the symptom, and it's just a matter of matching up what drug for what symptom. Or maybe what specialist refer them to, and you're done, doc. You've done your good primary care job. Well, we're now seeing that that's not really serving the patient as far as getting them healthier. There's a big factor being missed. And, of course, it's the food and lifestyle. And so that's what we need to focus on. It's kind of a long answer here, but as one who's been in lifestyle medicine and get people on plant-based diet and watch their bodies transform and the weight comes down and their arteries open up and the blood pressure comes down and these diseases start going away, it's a tragedy that this is not presented to the patient as the ultimate treatment for their disease. And I'm saying, and I thought to myself, someone should be telling the young medical students about this. Someone should do that. And a little voice on my shoulder said, how about you, doc? And so for the past 4 years, I've been going to the nation's medical schools trying to awaken the students to the fact that their patient's diet is the reason that they are sitting in front of you, overweight, diabetic, hypertensive, clogged up and inflamed. And a plant-based diet will reverse those diseases. So finally, it comes down to the one slide at the end of my slide presentation to the med students. I said, you want to heal these patients or you just want to manage their chronic disease? That's what it comes to. You want to heal these patients, then get real about what they're eating because that's why they're sitting in front of you, doctor. But if you're just going to manage their chronic disease, you'll leave medicine. It's a dismal way to practice medicine. Nobody's getting healthier. So, so it's a matter I'm playing kind of Paul Revere or Johnny Appleseed, throwing out these ideas that bring the dietitian onto your treatment team. When you see the patient in an outpatient clinic, be a doctor and take your medical history, do your physical exam, order your labs. But before you tell the patient, we'll see you in a month, say, lean across the desk. I want you, before you leave, go see Miss Wilson in room 121. She's the plant-based dietitian. Or Mr. Jones in 428. He's the plant-based dietitian. He's going to talk to you about what to eat. Going to use some handouts, show you some videos, take you shopping. You eat like they're telling you, and you come back and see me in a month. Let's see if you're not leaner and healthier. That's how medicine should be practiced in the 21st century. And this is the model that we're trying to instill in these young doctors' heads and the medical students before what I describe as pharmacosclerosis sets into their brains and they think that drugs and surgery are the only treatments because it's the food that you got.
Yeah. But there's so much to unpack there. I do love the aspect of horizontal versus vertical medicine. So if you walk into the doctor's office and you're still standing, maybe consider changing your lifestyle and your nutrition. If you're horizontal, different conversation, then that's great. Western medicine. I do believe again that there is a place for it when the situation is very extreme, right? There's just lifestyle changes. It's a little bit slower of a change. And if you're in a horizontal position, you need help now, right? And yeah, it's interesting you mentioned how like the prescription of kind of medicine and how the medicine system has kind of evolved throughout the years. I feel like there's been a massive cultural shift. And like you said, people weren't as overweight before. Now they're more overweight, right? What are the numbers? Like 70 or 80% of people wouldn't qualify to go to war or to go into the army right now because how much people are overweight. Yeah. It's interesting. I can just think back like 10 years ago. And I'm just not even going to grab meat. I'm just going to grab the culture of snacking, right? Like snacking wasn't really a thing a decade ago, but right. Now it's become this cultural thing and it's become so profitable that so many companies jumped in on it. And now it's been embedded into our culture of like, yeah, you're a snacker now. People don't eat meals. They just snack throughout the day, which makes, you know, a tremendous difference in how their body's going to feel and their health.
Yeah, absolutely. Eating has become a recreational activity. You know, it's just mindless shoveling as you're sitting at the computer or watching TV and especially what they're shoveling in, all the meat and the dairy and the sugars and the oils, et cetera. Not a healthy food stream. If they were eating hummus dipped on their carrot sticks there, that'd be one thing. But by and large, they're not. They're usually out of brightly colored packages and boxes. Edible food-like substances, but not real food.
Yeah. And ultimately, if you were to snack on hummus and carrots and celery, there's just so much you can eat. At a point, you're satiated, right? You're full, your taste buds are great. But man, if I give you two packs of Oreos, you're going to eat that whole thing and still want more after.
Exactly. And the food company, you know, there where lots of money is involved. Oh, where people get creative, and the food companies have been fiendishly ingenious in creating these what they're called hyper palatable foods, where they know that salt, sugar, and fat taste good on the tongue. So let's see how many different ways we can package salt, sugar, and fat. Make it chocolate flavored, make it peppermint flavored, make it crunchy, whatever it is. But again, it's just still this. Toxic food stream of salt, sugar, and fat that really hurt us on so many levels on the inside there, and we can't be slaves to our tongue, to our taste buds.
Yeah, and that's why I'm excited to see more plant-based advocates start to come out with their own products. Right, McDougal has his own line, Rip has his own line.
Yep.
But at least coming out with healthy alternatives that for people that are used to eating out of the can or the box can have a better alternative ultimately as a point of transition. All right, and great.
Yes.
If there's money to be made and there's enough profit to be made in like whole food plant-based type of products, the venture capitalists will just go and pump money into it because they just want to make money. They don't really care what the thing is that they're selling.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And so more power to them. The more of these good, healthy plant-based products that come out, yay, I'm all for them.
Yeah. So talking about like when you go into schools to kind of teach doctors, what does that look like? Like what is the kind of information that you pass on to them that ultimately I'm going to assume that you're trying to educate them, but to a certain point, convince them to be like, hey, here's the proof, here's the data. So what is that information that you share with them just so that the listeners can have some of these empowering tools?
Well, thank you for that question. this is pretty careful, the edge, revolutionary, bordering on heretical heresy that I'm bringing into the medical curriculum here. The idea that, one, that the major killer diseases that most doctors spend most of their careers treating And in my presentation to the medical students and the residents, et cetera, were entitled "What I Wish I Learned in Medical School About Nutrition," and it's available on our website for anyone to visit. If you go to movingmedforward.com, you can watch my presentation about what I'm actually telling the medical students. And I showed them that this is what happens to your bloodstream after you eat a cheeseburger. And I show them how fatty their blood turns and what the salt does and the sugar does and the oils do and how the blood stays this way for hours after eating such a meal and the damage it does through to the artery walls, to the insulin receptors, to the inflammatory mechanisms. And it starts constructing the wall of disease that we are all dealing with. And I tell them, it doesn't matter what not only specialty you go into, but any health related field. If you go into nursing, dentistry, pharmacy, the occupational therapy, doesn't matter. When you open the door of the waiting room to see who's waiting to see you that day, who's sitting there, Mr. and Mrs. America. Statistically, they're going to be overweight, if not obese. They're going to have clogged arteries or elevated lipids. They're going to have abnormal glucose tolerance because their insulin receptors are all clogged up with fat. And they're going to have inflammation of some organ system, lungs, gut, joints, heart, etc. And again, these are all dietary-driven diseases. And so I say, you're all dealing with diet-related diseases. Start knowing that there's no mystery. And in the presentation, I put up two words, etiology unknown. You know, this is what you run into when you ask your professors, what's the cause of high blood pressure? What's the cause of clogged arteries? What's the cause of type 2? Etiology unknown. We don't know the cause of these diseases. There must be some genetic component. And there is, I'm sure. But again, the thought that it's the food that's driving this, oh, they don't want to open that door for all sorts of reasons. They don't know what to do with it. And again, it forces them to look at their own diet. So so I want to get this message out that, again, the food is driving these diseases. These are reversible diseases. Because when I went through med school, and certainly the young doctors now, nobody's ever talking about, you want to make diabetes go away, type 2 diabetes? You want to make hypertension go away? You want to reverse that disease? Those words never get uttered. It's all, let's control the symptoms. Let's manage the disease. Mm. You know, like this curse has fallen upon the person from Jupiter, and a person has no control over it. They're innocent victims that only the doctor can help them control their ultimate fate, which is going to be a dismal death. Well, that's simply untrue. And so I want to get that message out to them. These are reversible diseases, that a plant-based diet is not only adequate, but it's the key to reversing these diseases. Those are four really important messages to get across to these students. So how do we do it? Because as I mentioned, this is heresy to the standard medical teaching. It rocks their intellectual understanding of etiology unknown. It's largely, yes, there's a genetic component, but as they say, your genes may load the gun, but your diet and your lifestyle pull the trigger. You may have a genetic propensity towards diabetes or hypertension, but whether those genes actually express in disease, largely, not completely, but largely depends on the food you are flowing through your cells with every meal, and that turn genes on and turn genes off. Our genetics are not written in stone. They are amenable to outside factors, largely our diet, but stress and the environment, et cetera, et cetera. So when I tell them they have control over this genetic component. And finally, because this is, as I said, this is heresy to the establishment's intellectual understanding, it certainly challenges their treatment model, because now it's just, you see the doctor, makes a diagnosis and is sent off to the pharmacy. Now you pull the dietitian onto the primary care team. So that shakes up their treatment model for sure. Yeah. And then, and certainly it challenges their financial model. The Western medicine makes money off every procedure that is done, every stent, every angiogram. Money is made for doing things to people to treat their disease states. But we're not paying doctors to do nutrition counseling. We don't pay doctors to say eat broccoli. And so the financial model is threatened by this. So knowing that, we don't knock on the door of administration saying, we'd like to give a lecture to your medical students that's going to challenge everything you're teaching them. Fortunately, podcasters like you and the social media, for all its being maligned for misinformation, one thing it has done is made some powerful truths available to the general public. And what's made my job easier is that now in every medical school class, every first, second, third year medical school class, there's 20, 30, 40 students. They've seen films like Forks Over Knives. They've seen What the Health. They've seen Cowspiracy. They've maybe done a Rochester Lifestyle Medicine Grand Rounds. The light's on. They're reading Dr. Greger's nutritionfacts.org, listening to podcasts like you. So the door has been opened intellectually for me. And we go through that door and swing it wide open and say, "This is, you're not crazy. This is where you want to be looking." And so we give the presentation. Oh, and so the American College of Lifestyle Medicine, bless them, now has residency programs and what are called Lifestyle Medicine Interest Groups, LMIGs, in many medical schools. These are just students and residents and professors who have an interest in lifestyle medicine and plant-based nutrition. And so we find out the names of the leader of the local LMIG, the local Lifestyle Medicine Interest Group, and say, would you like to have a Dr. Klaper lecture? And they all invariably say, sure, let's set it up. And so we go right to the students and they arrange the presentation. If it's a live presentation, I still go to med schools, they order the samosas in from the Indian restaurant and have the students come in at lunchtime and we give the presentation in person, but most of them are done over Zoom these days and over a virtual medium. And we allow time for questions, which are always stimulating. And so the message gets delivered one way or the other, virtually or in person, but we go right to the students and the response has been overwhelmingly positive because, again, it'd be a long answer, but when you're a first, second, third year med student, fourth year med student, you want to get those medical powers. You want to learn those medical tools. You want to learn how to use antibiotics to make pneumonia go away, how to use diuretics to make edema go away. And so I tell them, listen, you want the most powerful tool of all, the one that actually reverses these diseases, the most powerful tool you will ever wield in your practice. It's a plant-based diet, a whole food plant-based diet for your patients that actually reverses these diseases. And boy, they are open to that. And many of them have their own health issues, et cetera. So it's exciting to talk to these young minds and the healers of the not too distant future. They become chief residents and attending physicians before you know it. And this is how we're going to change the Western medical practice, the medical models, like turning an ocean liner. But you get enough of these young docs coming up who have that nutritional awareness. And pretty soon, different prescriptions start getting written, different referrals to plant-based dietitians start getting made. And it's going to start having effect financially. These people are going to be healthier people. There'll be less insurance claims. Insurance rates should start coming down. I'm waiting for some enterprising young vegan insurance person to start a vegan insurance company. And because these folks have a lot fewer claims, I'm sure. So the money will follow. So that's going to happen as well. So we go right to the students, a long answer to a short question. We go right to the students and they are hungry, so to speak, for the information. And it's been very gratifying.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that. And I can see how it would be a disruption to, like, let's be honest, the medical system is a very well-oiled machine. Mm-hmm. Right? They've gotten down to, I don't know, I built a business for a doctor like a year ago. That was not for medicine. It was more for coaching, but he was telling me in his practice, he had like 15 minutes or something, or 20 minutes to see each patient. Like, and he was seeing like 50 people a day. It was back to back. And it's such a well-oiled machine that I can see how it would be a disruption. And it would be interesting to see if the funding, because I know you're not supposed to pay doctors to prescribe things. So, you know, you get private trips, you know, cool things appear in your life magically from some of these drug companies. I know a few doctors that have shared that. But if the funding from the drug companies kind of went away and the doctors were left like, hey, I actually have to prescribe the best thing and I have no financial incentive to either prescribe a drug or a whole food plant-based lifestyle, I think that a lot more doctors would change. But because their lifestyle, their livelihood is tied to some of the funding that they get, you know, they're like, I'm doing it for my family, right? And I think that's why they're leaning more in that direction.
Absolutely. I was speaking, I ran into a lovely man who's a plant-based insurance actuary from Omaha. And we were having lunch at a meeting, and he said, look, doc, there's plenty of money in this system. He says, here, let me just sketch this out for you. He says, every time someone needs a four-vessel coronary artery bypass procedure for clogged arteries in their heart, having angina or whatever, by the time we pay the surgeon and the anesthesia and the operating room fee and the recovery room and the post-op rehab and all, By the time the dust settles, we've shelled out about $250,000, about $250,000 for every, you know, the whole package for bypass. he says, look, if nobody talks to that man and he goes right out and starts eating his burgers and buffalo wings and spare ribs, he's going to clog up his arteries within months. And he's going to come back and need another procedure, maybe a more extensive one. And it's just a black hole for money, for funding. And that money, it's a waste. That money could be used for college scholarships. It could be used to put internet in everybody's houses. The medical care in a way without nutrition counseling, it's just a black hole for funds, but nobody's getting healthier. He said, look, the trick is keep these people healthy. Through plant-based nutrition, lifestyle counseling, et cetera, because the numbers work like this. The bean counters have to change the way the beans are flowing because that $250,000 for every CEO of a local company that doesn't go down with a heart attack, his company still stays intact, paychecks keep getting printed, money gets spent in the community, taxes get paid. The community benefits from keeping these people healthy. And if you can, and for every bypass that doesn't happen, we're sitting on $250,000. The insurance company we'll pay that doctor $20,000 for keeping his patients healthy for 10 years. We'll pay the patient $10,000 for staying healthy. We're still sitting on $200,000 profit. There's money in the system that if you start rewarding people for being healthy, could, you know, it could be changed to promote healthy diet and lifestyle. And he says, and here's another little model that the government could really help with at no cost. He says, we pay our federal income tax April 15th. He says, well, for the 90 days ahead of that, on January 15th, make a general notice, put it on TV commercials, billboards on the buses, etc. Tell everybody that from January 15th to April 15th, if you go down to your local pharmacy where there's a little minute clinic there and there's a nurse or technician there, you walk in, you register, and she throws a blood pressure cuff on your arm. And if your blood pressure is no more than 140 over 80, take 5% off your income tax. She'll have you, she'll stick your finger. And if your hemoglobin A1C is under 6, take another 5% off. She'll also do a finger stick cholesterol, and if it's below 160, take another 5% off. She'll have you stand on a scale. If you're no more than 5 pounds over your ideal body weight, take another 5% off your income tax. And she'll have you pee in a cup, and if there's no cotinine in your urine from nicotine, you're a non-smoker, take another 5% off. And so just for being having a normal body weight and normal cholesterol, blood sugar, blood pressure, and being a non-smoker, 25%, 30% off your income tax. And she gives you a little slip and she says, here you go, clip this to your IRS tax return and they'll knock your final taxes down 25, 30%. Doesn't cost you anything.
I'd be rich.
Yeah, exactly. So it could be done. You know, all it takes is the political will and to see where our priorities are. As you say, the current system is so cynical and so built to extract money off of every aspirin that's dispensed in the hospital, every Band-Aid. And again, it's disease care. It's not a health care, it's disease care. And it's not serving us. It needs to be changed.
Yeah. And, you know, there's the flip side of the cost, right? There's like, there's getting the surgery and the doctors make money and an insurance company makes money. But on the flip side, as a patient that is getting that surgery, that is a massive medical bill, right? Like I know right now you're in Canada. I'm Canadian still. So we do get free healthcare in Canada. I'm currently living in Los Angeles, just got married. So I'll actually be living here. So I need to get insurance to be here. But man, you get a bill like that. Like some people go to hospital, $100,000, $200,000, $300,000, and people still complain that eating whole food plant-based or eating vegan is very expensive. The payments on $300,000 a medical bill is a lot more.
Oh, it's stunning. And as you said, I've recently relocated up to British Columbia and I'm working in a lifestyle medical clinic in Victoria, BC. And the Canadian medical system, too, it's straining under all the obese, diabetic, hypertensive Canadians who've been eating the standard Canadian diet and living at Tim Hortons and these fast food restaurants. And they're suffering the same problem. Yeah. And the Canadian care system is creaking financially. They're hoping that they're really open to lifestyle medicine. If you can get these people healthier so they need less care, please do it now. And so as I've joined this practice, it's been very encouraging for me to hear. I said, where do you get your patients? He says, oh, we're on very good terms with the Victoria medical community. The cardiologists send us their patients, the gastroenterologists send us their patients, the rheumatologists send us their patients, because we know we get them healthy and reduce their draw.
Well, on the island, so Victoria and Vancouver, it's very like health centric, but you go through war, you go to Alberta, different conversation, right? You go to like Winnipeg, different conversation, but I've lived everywhere in Canada. Victoria and Vancouver are some of the best ones.
Similar with the U.S. as well, of course. You get some enlightenment on in some states, and others are they like their animal products, to say the least.
Yeah, absolutely. So I wanted to ask, like, when you're going to schools to kind of teach the students, are you primarily talking to new medical students that are just starting their protocol, or people that are more towards the end? And do you notice a difference in openness to receiving the information?
Very, very astute question. I try to get them as early as possible. I like to talk to the first and second year students, as I said before.
Before they've been conditioned.
Exactly, for their brain, and I use the term pharmacosclerosis, but sclerosis, man, something sclerotic is hard and frozen in place there, and this is the idea that drugs are the treatment, and I want to reach them before pharmacosclerosis encases this mindset into their brains there, and the first, second year students are very, very open to the message, but to answer your question, by the time they're in the fourth year, they're kind of sitting in the back with their arms folded, and they show me the proof. Show me the. I want 15 double-blind placebo-controlled studies proving that broccoli is healthier than Snickers bars. Okay, show me the studies, and they can be a little bit too much the other way, but most of them, when I speak to them, they know that it is the food. There are barriers, cultural barriers. A lot of the students now, I'm grateful to see, I'm delighted, I celebrate. Many of them are from Hispanic upbringings, East Indian upbringings, and they've got their own cultural approaches to food. And And your mother didn't know, my mother didn't know, their mother didn't know. We learn these as children. We get our eating habits, our comfort food tastes are ingrained in us from early on. And these are difficult barriers that we have to have compassion for. Wagging fingers never work in the medical clinic or in life in general. Everybody's on their journey. We're all awakening at the rate we awaken. And you have to have compassion for people wherever they are in their journey. Meet them there and help them. It's just food, and choosing the bean chili instead of the beef chili is not that great a jump there if you if you're compassionate and especially make it taste good. So you gotta reach people at their own levels. And so I with the both the early med students and the later ones, we start with where they're at, what they ate, what their favorite foods are. And after we talk about the science of what food really does to the body there, we thought, well, how could we tweak this? Is the oil really helping their arteries? Is the are these concentrated sugars, can they be replaced with fruits? Are there ways that we could make this diet healthier? And of course, don't use the V word too much, but we certainly let them know that a diet, the more whole plant foods you eat, the healthier you are going to be. And a vegan diet is absolutely compatible with spectacular health and performance.
Yeah, is that interesting? The word vegan is so triggering to certain people, but
Oh,
plant-based people are just a lot more receptive to it.
indeed. And again, I've been vegan for 42 or 3 years, 1981. And I've watched that term and society's response to it evolve over these last four decades here. And it's sad. It's such a beautiful word, beautiful concept. And but it gets to the heart of people's personal approach to life, to food, to family, to money. It's deeply intertwined with so many profound foundational concepts in the human spirit there. What you order for lunch says a lot about you and your approach to the world, your approach to animals. And so it's a delicate subject to talk about, but it's the most important subject of all. Truth of it is, especially nowadays, the environmental ramifications. So there's no nothing is served by not talking about the food.
Yeah, people have such a strong emotional attachment to the foods that they eat, but also I think there's a big piece of identity, like to identify as this person that eats this way. And then when you go to kind of propose something else, it's as if you're attacking them personally. And I feel like that's why people are not as receptive to it.
Absolutely, absolutely. And it's easier to talk to some people about a sex change operation than a diet change.
It's true.
It's remarkable.
So
You'll
I
pry that burger out of my cold, dead hands. Well, unfortunately, it's often what it comes to pass here. And we want to spare people that fate for sure.
yeah. So I'm curious, like, what are some of the most common questions you get from medical students when you do these presentations? Because obviously they're trained not on that. They're trained primarily on, like, hey, there's this drug for this symptom of this situation. Now that you're proposing an alternative, which, I kind of wrote this in my notes before, seems a little bit crazy. And I feel from their point of view, it's like, hey, there's this drug for this problem. There's a different drug for this problem. And now we're coming in, it was like, hey, I have this one size fits all solution to a certain extent. And so I'm curious, like, what are the questions that come up?
Indeed, and you've really put your finger on some important issues there. The most common question I get at the thought of do not eat animal products or don't eat meat. Well, where are you going to get your protein? The number one there. And the images that all vegans are on death's door from protein deficiency, and they need to be eating cheeseburgers at 2 in the morning when no one's looking. Well, it doesn't work like that, of course, and it's embarrassing to me. One reason that I'm doing this is my sense of embarrassment at the medical profession's profound, gaping black hole of ignorance when it comes to the effect of food on the human body. And they don't know about it. They don't want to look at it. And And so the nutritional ignorance is profound, one of which is the around the protein issue there. And I have to say, listen, the biggest, most powerful animals on the planet, elephants and buffaloes and giraffes, gorillas, they grow these spectacularly muscular bodies without ever eating animal flesh. There, the protein's in the plant foods. It's in the beans and peas and chickpeas and lentils and nuts and seeds. Plenty of protein. I've never written protein deficiency up for any diagnosis
Is there one
on a
though?
patient. So relax. It's in the, and I and we I have a slide with a bunch of foods in it showing that if you eat of this day, eating with selections, you're going to get 80, 90 grams of protein. So I really have to confront the protein issue.
Yeah, question for you. Is
Yes.
there an actual protein deficient diagnosis? And if there is one, what would be needed to get that? Is that a
Oh,
thing?
well, it's borders on starvation. This is kwashiorkor, and these people are in dreadful physical shape. You see, they are emaciated and sallow, and their hair is falling out. It's just gross protein deficiency. It just does not happen. The body will cannibalize its own proteins, before you get to that dreadful terminal state. So it's, again, just simply not an issue. If you eat 2,000 calories of whole plant foods, especially those with any legumes in it, beans, peas, chickpeas, lentils, 2,000 calories of whole plant foods, you are guaranteed, you can't avoid getting 50, 60, 70 grams of high grade protein. It's in the
Yeah.
plant foods. And so it's just not an issue. If you're living on Oreos and energy drinks, yeah, that's something else.
Yeah.
But that's why we say whole food plant-based. If you're getting your day's calories out of whole plant foods, your protein needs are going to be easily covered. Not an issue. You don't have to combine them. Your body knows how to take care of that for you. The other questions I get, and there's some legitimacy to it, but again, another overlay of misinformation is the myth. And it comes from the question comes from a sincere place. Listen, my family, they're people of various ethnic origins. I live in a food desert. There is nothing but a 7-Eleven within 3 miles of me, and they just got a couple of spotty old bananas rotting there for fresh produce there. In a food desert, you're telling me to go get broccoli and kale, and you're kidding yourself, Doc. And that's an issue. And so, by the way, it's expensive to eat this way. What arugula costs these days? And so the food desert issue and the expense of it often gets the guys in the back with their arms full. This is impractical. Well, you got to unpack that, because the truth is, those are two. At least one unnecessary obstacle. Why? Because the truth of it is that the staple foods, the foods that contribute the most calories and the most protein, that's what you really need to keep the furnace going, are cheap. We're
Yeah.
talking about whole starch, beans and rice and lentils and potatoes. They're
Potatoes, yeah.
cheap. You can buy a 10-pound bag of lentils for $10. You can buy a 10-pound bag of rice for $6. 2 cups of rice, 2 cups of lentils will give any adult all the protein they need for the day. And that's a month's worth of supply for 20, a month's supply of food for $20. So the truth is, especially if you make these bulk purchases and you make up these big hearty stews and chilies and curries, et cetera, you can eat often for 3 days, freeze half of it. Batch cooking of these healthy, hearty, staple foods is actually quite cheap. Your food
Yeah.
costs go down. And if you're not spending money for steaks and ice cream and so you got money to buy kale and broccoli with. So the financial thing, that's a straw man. That's really should not be an obstacle. But again, the food system is slanted, so the agricultural subsidies make cheeseburgers artificially cheap. But that's
Yeah.
economics and politics. We won't go into that right now. The food desert thing—that's a thing—and it takes sometimes medicine is you get out of the operating room, doctor. Sometimes, well, I've got a couple of emergency room friends. They're ER docs. who live in a food desert. One of them's got a pickup truck. And so every Saturday morning, they hop in the pickup truck, they drive 15 miles to the local farmers market. And as the farmer market merchants are all closing down, and all the produce they haven't sold that day, they're willing to sell for pennies on a dollar there. And so my ER doc friends go around, they buy up all the food all the produce that the merchants don't want to take back with them. And so they drive away with this pickup truck full of fruits and vegetables, and they bring it back to their community, and they either give it a food bank, they give it away off the back of the truck. There's ways to get this to the community. Sometimes being a physician, being a healer means getting in your pickup truck and getting some food, good food into your neighborhood there. There's ways to do this. We're Americans and Canadians. We were can-do people. We can't let that be an obstacle for us. So we need to rise to the challenge, but the food will nourish us. The nutrients are in these whole plant foods.
That's a great strategy. I didn't even think about waiting till the end. And are you familiar with Doug Evans? You heard of him before?
No, huh?
He was a Silicon Valley type of guy, built a few businesses in the vegan space and like the whole food raw space. But he basically started a Sprout company. I had him on the show a few weeks ago, and he lives in a food desert out in like 29 Palm, Joshua Tree area in California.
You know it
And
well.
he's like, sprouts, they're cheap, right? They're cheap. You can grow them, they're alive. And he's in a food desert. And he's like, I have tons of sprouts that I just live on. And whenever I have other foods, I just eat other foods.
Yeah, absolutely. Where there's a will, there's a way. And yeah, can be.
So what's kind of like the one of the rebuttals that you get the most often from students when it comes to kind of being able to propose that to patients? Like, is there a question of, well, the hospital is wanting us to push certain drugs? Again, I don't know how the system works precisely, but is it like all these companies or the hospital wants us to push these certain drugs or kind of procedures? And like, how do we fit that in our practice?
Absolutely. And that's some ways the crux of the dilemma here. And because again, these are just a third year med student, fourth year med students. And I tell them, listen, don't rock the boat politically, as you go through your medical education. Don't get into arguments with professors. Why aren't we offering plant-based diets to our diabetic patients in the hospital? There'll come a time for that, but don't put your own career in danger. Don't get a note put in your dossier that you're a troublemaker, you're a vegan agitator, or whatever. You're there to learn medicine, learn your craft, learn your trade, and then when you get out and practice on your own, then you practice medicine like you know it ought to be practiced in a plant-based in a plant-based model. That said, there have been a number of medical students and young residents who have agitated because Western medicine's gotten so strange and monstrous. When you walk into the lobby of a healing bastion hospital, and there's a freaking McDonald's and a Burger King in the lobby there. What is that? And you see the trays come up from dietary from within the hospital to the sick patients, and it's full of eggs and meat and cheese, and including in the coronary care unit, these people just had a heart attack, and the next morning the bacon and eggs come up from dietary. And what are we saying to these patients with that? And a number of young medical students and residents have said that exceeds the limit of acceptability. Then they've gone to the dietary department and they say, how about at least a plant-based option for the patients to choose? And in many hospitals, the dietitians say, okay, and they've gone along with that. Mayor Eric Adams in New York has gotten a plant-based entree. That's the default choice now in all New York hospitals. The inpatients are going to get a plant-based option unless they choose otherwise. They're yay, good to see that. So it's starting to happen. Ask and you shall receive, I think the old saying is. And if we ask for it, the times are right. The public is wanting this. And the hospitals know that they need to make these changes. So there are some good signs, and just because you're a student doesn't mean you're powerless, but you got to be appropriate as the situation requires. They said when you get out, open up a plant-based clinical practice, a plant-based lifestyle medicine, and they will come, Dr. Bilden, and they will come. I guarantee the times are changing, as Bob Dylan says. So there are hopeful signs, but the students, you got to tell them sometimes you got to be politically astute, or pick your fights and pick your battles, and you'll win more of them if you're prudent.
Yeah, absolutely. And I understand that because when I was back in the day going through my personal training certification, there's a nutritional component to the course. And it's like, yeah, chicken, steak, and fish. You need protein to build some muscle because you're trying to coach people as a personal trainer. And I was like, I know this is all bullshit, but I will just lie in my exam to say whatever they want me to say. Then I get my paper, then I can actually teach people properly. But yeah,
Exactly.
cause without the paper or the degree or whatever, it's really hard to kind of have that credibility to be able to coach people. So you just take the bullshit. You just answer whatever they want, and you dump it after you're done.
You got no one to hold them, no one to fold them, and yes, sometimes you guys just got to hold them and get through with it, and then go out and practice like you need to. Good for you. That's a good object lesson.
Yeah, there's a time to fight. That wasn't the
There's a
right
time. There's a
time.
time.
So, what are resources that patients can have access to that could potentially bring to their physician? Because fortunately, I hear more and more stories of members going to the doctors and the doctor actually prescribing a whole food plant-based diet, and they're in the middle of Ohio, and I'm like, this is great. Like, I didn't really expect your doctor to prescribe that, but there are still some physicians that are not as open to the idea, but the patient are, right? They're like, hey, I've done my own research. I know that I believe wholeheartedly that eating a whole food plant-based might be able to help me. What can some of these patients do to kind of, I know it would be rough to try to educate a doctor, but to be able to kind of provide resources and nudge them in that direction.
Absolutely, so important. And it's exciting and gratifying. I've been in the trenches here for 40 years trying to get plant-based nutrition accepted, and it's starting to happen. And as you say, and so it's amazing. Well, in the middle of Ohio, there's a plant-based doc there who's getting wonderful successes with his patients, and those little lights are going on across the country. It's happening slowly, but it's happening. So I take great comfort from that and great encouragement from that. So knowing that, and again, it's the communicators, it's the podcasters, and the educators that are really making this happen. They're that are sowing the soil and making it fertile as far as people's understanding. So the plant idea of going plant-based not so strange anymore. And then you guys get a lot of credit for that. But what is about the individual person? Quite honestly, a couple of things. It may be worthwhile just asking the physician, Doctor, do you have any recommendations of what I ought to be eating? And let them lay out where they're at with that. And you're going to hear everything you need to know. If they say, it doesn't matter what you eat, just get some protein, blah, 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 then you've heard what you need to hear. Your doctor really is not aware of the importance of nutrition and the various types of it. Fine, okay. Never worth getting into a fight with your doctor about anything. And many of them don't mention the word vegan. Don't mention anything that may have a little political tone to it, because they write you off as a troublemaker, as a kook, as soon as you label yourself that. Because ultimately, it doesn't matter what I'm going to say. We'll get back to the doctor in a minute. But the most important thing that any patient can do is to educate themselves about what a proper whole food plant-based diet is, what a day of healthy eating is, and just do it yourself. You don't have to mention a thing to your doctor. You just do it. And if you're overweight with high blood pressure and diabetes, you can tell your doctor, listen, I'm eating a healthier diet now. My weight might go down. You want to work with me? So if I need to lower these medications for blood pressure, blood sugar, you'll help me with that. That's all you have to say. And you don't have to, sometimes less is more. Too much information, TMA, can get you in trouble there. Just tell the doctor you're eating healthier and that you want her or him to work with you to adjust your medications as needed. That's all you have to do. You, the patient, go and eat those salads and soups and steamed veggies and veggie chilies and stews and curries, and let the food work its magic on your body. And hopefully your doctor, as you come in 20 pounds later, will say, well, what have you been doing there? You're looking good. And then's your chance to educate your doctor. and just have a link to the website for Forks Over Knives and say, Dad, just watch this video. You'll understand what I'm doing and why I'm doing it. And let the movie do the talking for you. You don't have to get into a big philosophical conflict with your doctor there. So see if they're open to the idea, as I said, to ask them what their view of nutrition is, anything they think you ought to be doing. You might want to ask them if they've heard of plant-based nutrition. If not, that's all you need to say. You just go home and do it yourself. You don't need your doctor's permission to eat beans instead of beef there. So you eat healthy and your body will do the talking for you.
Yeah, beautiful. I think that's a great strategy because it can get pretty heated if you decide to, and you only have 15 minutes to do it too, because you have to see another patient. So it's not like you have a lot of time to convince them.
Right, exactly. No need to stir up the waters unnecessarily.
Yeah, awesome. So what current projects are you working on that we can support either through the people listening or I have a few links I can put in the description for you?
Right. Well, thank you. My job, there's 150 medical schools in North America. If we can hit 50 of them a year, if I can do one a week, over the next 3 years, next 36 months, we'll hit all 150 of them. And but we need but I don't want this to be just a one-time drive-by lecture. It's called, I'll get you get the interest up, and then as the weeks go by, the enthusiasm fades. So we need to hire some folks to stay in contact with the medical schools that where I've lectured, and to recontact them a month or two after my initial lecture, saying, "What do you need to keep the lights, keep the nutrition interest going here? Do you need Q&A with Dr. Klaper once a month? Do you need how about a plant-based journal club where people bring in articles from the medical journals about plant-based nutrition? You want to show some films? You want a controversial guest speaker? What do you need to keep the nutrition flame burning here?" And so I want to keep revisiting these schools, and we can combine three or four med schools with one session there for a Q&A or a journal club or whatever. But we need money to do this. And so if people would like to contribute to our 501c3 nonprofit organization, Moving Medicine Forward, I'm sure you'll put the link there, movingmedforward.com. So that would certainly help us. And we're working on a 3 or 4 page handout that people can give to their doctor. This is why I've gone plant-based, doctor. Here's the proof, the documentation that it lowers blood pressure, lowers blood sugar, et cetera, and so we want to get that on our website as well. So it's a matter of reaching more medical students, and we want to graduate an entire new generation of plant-based aware doctors and dietitians and nurses and dentists and pharmacists, but certainly the MDs are the tip of the spear there. And we want, and what if every young doctor at every visit, no matter what the patient came in for, a sprained wrist, a urinary tract infection, at the end say, "By the way, how's your plant-based diet going? I went plant-based a year ago. I'm feeling great. How are you doing, Joe? How are you doing, Mary, with your dietary changes?" What if every doctor asked that at every visit? Well, it would change the entire complexion of medical care. That's what we're trying to create, with by graduating these nutritionally aware young doctors. They say you can't unring the bell. Once you look behind the curtain, you can't pretend you don't know what's behind the curtain. And my job is to pull that curtain down. It's the food, that a plant-based diet will reverse these diseases. If I can get that message in the heads of enough young doctors, then Western medicine will finally be a truly healing profession. And that's what we're trying to create.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I'll definitely put all the link down below in information. And we do have a lot of doctors and nurses that kind of follow us. So those of you guys that are listening that want to help the movement, reach out to the school that you went to, right? To get Dr. Klaper into the door. Because ultimately it's a very doable number, right? I thought there would be more schools than that, but yeah, it's a very doable number to reach. So if you simply send an email, right, to the school that you went to, that would make the world of a difference in helping to kind of move the movement forward. Because at the end of the day, I find it so interesting. Every vegan and doctor that I talk to, like I'm talking to Dr. Neil Bernard next week, And just Dr. Greger, like this is all of you guys, right? But no one has like massive financial incentive to push a plant-based diet. Like you don't get money from the farmer that's selling the potatoes for you to push plant-based, right? But on the flip side, the people that are pushing meat and the drugs and the fish and the chicken, there's money being paid out to those people that are promoting it. But the vegan movement, the plant-based movement, is the only one that doesn't gain financially. And it's purely out of the goodness of people's heart of wanting to help and or wanting to help other people feel the same way that we do. We feel so good. We're like, hey, we want other people to experience this. And so that's what I find so beautiful about this movement is that it's not about money. Obviously, money helps to move the cause forward, which is important to kind of support and donate and all that. But at the end of the day, there's no incentive from, you know, the tomato and the potato farmer giving money to the doctors to push this, right? It's out of the goodness of their own heart and their passion.
Indeed. I've not received a penny from Big Broccoli. I'm waiting for my first check, but
hasn't happened yet.
Hasn't happened yet, no. But again, it's a message that touched people's hearts and it resonates with their minds. And yes, that's right. Everybody who hears what we're doing says, yes, I wish my doctor knew something about nutrition. Well, that's what we're trying to create here. And again, it's podcasts like this that opens people's minds to these new ideas. And so this is where the change really happens. And I'm very grateful for having the opportunity to share this information with your viewers. So thank you.
Yeah. Well, thank you for taking the time to jump back on. I really appreciate it. Again, I think you're the first guest that comes a second time on the show since I've started in almost 4 years now. So it was a pleasure chatting with you. I'm really like excited about the work that you're doing. And so again, I'll put all the link down below for everyone listening. We'll spread the message and just, you know, massive thank you for jumping on the show.
Absolutely. Thank you. And all the best to you and your viewers. You're doing the most important work in the world. I wish you all the best.